Welcome to Breakthrough Success. I'm your host, Marc Guberti, CEO and founder of the Content Marketing Plaza, bringing you three new episodes each week where I and top-level guests teach you how to take your business to the next level and achieve your breakthrough. Now, it is great to go after breakthroughs and go after all the goals that you set for yourself, but one of the things that we want to talk about in this episode is that as we continue to pursue these big ambitions, we want to be grateful for what we have and not fall into the trap that many driven people do, where they continue going after more and more and more, and they don't really have a sense of contentment. They don't really have a sense of gratitude for where they are, for the things they've already accomplished. They're just looking for more, and they're focused on what they don't have, and that could create a very destructive cycle. So today's guest, he's going to join us today and talk a little bit about that. He is a serial entrepreneur and business founder who is focused on connecting high potential leaders with the ideas, resources, and people they need to grow their enterprises and have lasting leadership impact. Our guest also currently serves as the chairman and CEO of Cathedral Consulting, leading a team of consultants focused on providing financial systems, strategy, and merger and acquisition support to emerging businesses and nonprofits. So today's guest for episode 361 of the Breakthrough Success Podcast is none other than Seth Buechley. Seth, it is such a pleasure to have you on the show.
Marc, I'm super excited to be here with you and can't wait to dive into this topic.
Seth, I'm so happy to have you on the show. And I feel like there are so many people who they set big goals, which yes, kudos to you, keep setting big goals, but they're not taking time to see what they already have. They're looking at what they lack, and that's definitely a bad viewpoint. So we'll talk a little bit about that in this episode. Before we do, though, can you talk a little bit about how your background came? Because I know you wrote your book, Ambition. So can you share about how that came to be?
Sure. Well, you know, it's interesting. When I was in high school, I didn't enjoy school. I like learning. You know, I like information and insights, but I didn't like the structure of school. And I had a really tough English teacher. And one time I had written a paper and I got 100, and it was like one of two I'd ever heard about from this lady. And it was actually like a sonnet, and she encouraged me to write. And so I just kind of tucked that away in my head. I'm like, all right, someday I want to write a book. But of course, you know, you're like, geez, I should probably have a little bit of experience before I undertake writing a book. And you know, what would I write about? And, you know, but I tucked it away in the back of my mind. And, later on, I had an opportunity. So, you know, before that, what's kind of interesting about this story is I grew up in a commune in the woods of Southern Oregon. And so my parents were kind of in that hippie movement in California in the 60s and 70s. And they ended up with a bunch of other hippie types living in the woods of Southern Oregon. And I literally grew up there till I was, I think, 16 or 17. And, you know, I skipped school in terms of college. I married my high school sweetheart. So there's nothing about my story that would position me for the things that I've been able to do. And what I learned in the early days of the commune was kind of leadership, I think, done poorly. There was a lot of manipulation and a lot of trying to control people. And make a long story short, I was really motivated to prove certain people wrong. And so I like to say that our dysfunction will often drive us, right, until we take some time to deal with it. And, you know, the dysfunction in my case was I just had this agenda to prove people wrong, and that I just wanted to go. And when I was 27 years old, my dad and I were partners in a business, and we sold that business to a public company. And so there I was in my late 20s, and I kind of weaseled my way into serving on the board of this public company, and I had millions of dollars. And, you know, here I am, a kid that grew up in the commune and skipped school and, you know, all the things you shouldn't do as a career planner might suggest. And, I found myself in probably one of the toughest situations I'd ever been in, because I'd achieved something that was supposed to be, you know, really satisfying. And I actually felt a huge emotional crash, and went through one of the toughest periods in my life, because I was still driven and ambitious and doing all these things, but I had really lost connection to why, you know, what was motivating me. And it was a really difficult and challenging season.
Wow. And Yeah, your story brings out a big conflict a lot of people have. I mean, your accomplishments, like, just there. I mean, there's definitely a lot more. Really impressive to be able to do that. But then there's that, what's next? There's that, I want a little more. And in your case, even like if you lose sense of that why, because you have that, what's next? What do I do? And I think that's the point where people lose focus of what they've accomplished, their big thing they accomplished that they were so proud of a few months ago is now just a cliff note. It's something that's off to the side. So how do you continue to stay ambitious, set big goals, but not let your sense of more, I want more, make you feel like you're not enough?
Yeah. Well, that's a great question. I mean, I really think it boils down to getting clear on your purpose. And tying into that, making sure the work that you're doing lines up with what you think is the purpose. But, you know, there's a pretty big danger, Mark, that nobody talks about. And that is, I think really driven people are subjected to really profound disappointment. And there's two ways that disappointment often comes. And many times we're not prepared for that. The first way is we actually get that thing that we're chasing. And all of a sudden we're like, wow, the emotional payout, the payload that I thought that this was going to get me, you know, whether it's financial freedom or now I'm going to feel like I matter or now I'm going to whatever, they achieve that thing. And it's this goal that they'd set out, like, man, if I could ever get there, I would be happy. And they get it. And they're like, uh-oh, I'm still not fundamentally different. I'm the same person I was before this major goal, right? So that can be disappointing. And the other side of it is you fail. Right? You set these big ambitious goals because you're a driven person and you reach for the stars and everybody's saying, go, go, go. And then you fail. Either one of those things can be massive disappointment traps. And I find that many really driven people, they don't fully appreciate the dangers that come along with the personality. And that is, you know, you can be, you're just always out front. You're so forward focused, so into chasing that next thing, that you don't stop to value and appreciate, and therefore you don't even really protect all that you've been given, right? And so for me, this process of realizing, okay, I got to learn how to process disappointment in healthy ways. I got to realize that my identity is not necessarily found in my work. And I got to get a grip on the fact that, yeah, I'm driven, but how do I be driven without being uptight and frustrated all the time because the world is not coming into compliance with the way that I want to, you know, I want to chase it.
And you bring that up very interesting, the idea of protecting what we already have, because you have people who, they make the million, they want to figure out, how do I turn it into five? And again, correct, like, great goal to have, but if they put all their million into, like, they risk all their million and it doesn't work out. That's why you hear about people who, they make their million, then they go bankrupt, then they make the other million, then they go bankrupt, because they don't protect what they have, as Seth is like very greatly describing to us. And one of the things I do want to hit on next is the opposite side, where someone's listening to this right now or watching, if you're watching on YouTube, and you feel like you have this great ambition and you can relate. Like, yes, I feel like I want more and more and more. I'm not seeing myself as good. But then you have people who, they will take that and they will scale down the goal. So they will stop being ambitious.
Sandbagging. Yeah, they'll sandbag a little, right? Yeah.
Yeah. So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think a lot of ambition is hardwiring. You know, there's always this question, is it nature or is it nurture, right? What, nature meaning I was born this way, or nurture, I was trained and became this way. And I think it's a little both, but I fundamentally think being a driven go-getter is more hardwiring than it is environment. There's an interesting book by Virginia Pestrell, which says, listen, there's stasists and there's dynamists. Stasists find their safety and comfort and understanding the world, and they kind of position off of what is. And dynamists are always saying, show me what is so that I can figure out what to do. And I kind of chunk that into people that want to stay out of trouble and people that want to get things done, right? And people that want to get things done are always going to have these goals and these ambitions. But as you noted, I kind of envision the curvature of the earth. It's like, you know, you can see a certain destination and you set that out as a goal, like, wow, if I could ever get there, I would just be happy. But then when you get there, Now you can see past it. And that original goal, which was supposed to be the end all be all, is just like you say, it's a road marker as you move on to that next thing. And so you never really settle in. And so what I've discovered with driven personalities and people that are really ambitious, and that doesn't necessarily have to be in the world of business. It could be in academia. It could be in the world of medicine, you know, law. There's a lot of places where driven people hide out. But what I've observed is that we tell ourselves, and even society tells us, that satisfaction is found on the other side of achievement, right? Mm-hmm. What I've discovered and what I believe to be true is that satisfaction is on the other side of gratitude. That achievement doesn't ultimately satisfy. We become satisfied when we become more aware of where we're really at. We see clearly. And so for me and my personality, gratitude is the thing that helps me get clear on what is real. And so my definition of gratitude, Marc, is acknowledging a gift received. And whether somebody is a religious person or not a religious person, I think it's reasonable to say, hey, I showed up, I'm here, I'm in America in 2019 when this is being recorded. Man, I've got it pretty good relative to a whole bunch of other people throughout history. And when I look and start to take inventory of the environment, of my family, of all the opportunities I've been given to serve and to lead and to have impact and to have meaning, man, I got a lot to be thankful for. And if I go do my work, which is still important, and I still want to do it with a lot of excellence and a lot of energy, but I do my work from a place of look at how much I've been given and look at these tremendous opportunities I have versus let me try to fill this bucket, which happens to have a bunch of holes in it, which is this bucket of feeling good about myself through achievement. It just doesn't work.
Yeah, and that is a really interesting insight because if we act in this moment of gratitude, it's definitely easier for us to keep going, because I think part of the reason people stop is because they look at how much further they have to go ahead versus what they've already done. So if you look at gratitude, not just from like how far you've gone, business or whatever goal you're going after, but also like, you know, really simple stuff that Seth said that we take for granted, like maybe having good parents or just being born in the right country or being born in the right time frame where all these opportunities do exist. Because, you know, like 30, 40 years ago, who was really doing all this stuff like social media, blogging, podcasting? A lot of those were not options for most of history. So, I mean, there's a lot of different things to be grateful for. And I think gratitude is great, but sometimes we have a struggle bringing it into the forefront, like really thinking about it every day. So how are you, Seth, able to make gratitude a daily practice, something that you keep thinking about versus something that you think about once, like maybe you're inspired from this episode and then you stop?
Yeah. Well, that's a great question. I'd be lying if I told you I think about it every day. I will tell you though, that I use it more like a very powerful tool than a soft skill that's just optional. For me, it's actually life-saving. Is I can get very frustrated and overwhelmed because I like to start stuff. I'm always involved as an investor, as a leader, as a speaker, author, etc. I could get very, very diffused. And some days I wake up and I'm like, I don't care about any of that. I'm just frustrated because whatever, overwhelmed. You know, I live in Oregon. Sometimes the skies are gray. And I find that for me, gratitude reorients me to what is real. The things I see aren't necessarily real. And so I need gratitude. And so I use what I call a gratitude adjustment. I often do this in the shower. I tell people you'll never take a shower the same way, right? And for me, I think about God. I think about the world that He created. I think about the sacrifice of Christ. I'm a Christ follower. I think about that and what it means for me personally. I think about the fact that I'm a forgiven person. And then I move immediately into what I call my domains, which are, these are the areas that I have been given to serve: my family, the organizations, the platform I have, the opportunity that I have to speak to people like you and have a message go out. And as I process through that, and I just think about those most important things being dealt with, then I feel like it reorients me. You know, I tell people, try to be angry and grateful at the same time. Try to hold a grudge against somebody while you're expressing gratitude for all the good things in your life. It's virtually impossible. And so for me, gratitude, I think, you know, I think Cicero said it's the mother of all other virtues. You know, I actually think humility is probably a higher value virtue, but I think the way you get to humility is through gratitude, because gratitude is acknowledging these gifts that we have in our life. And I think that that should, you know, make us humble. So I will challenge myself when I'm feeling frustrated, anxious, irritated, overwhelmed. I use gratitude to reorient me, to just ratchet it back, to acknowledge, hey, I'm not holding this world together. You know, this whole idea of receiving a gift implies that we're not the ones that create everything, right? And so just like I said, whether somebody's religious or not, to say, listen, there's things in my life I didn't create. Therefore, the future isn't something I'm going to go be responsible entirely for myself. And I can just relax a little bit and say, you know, regardless of the outcome, my job in the middle of this is to be joyful and faithful. If I do my work well, the outcomes will be there.
And Seth, that's a really interesting insight, because one of the things, you can't be angry and have gratitude at the same time. So if you have some way to remember to be grateful, you can have that those feelings overpower the anger, and then you think more clearly, you have a better outlook of the day. So I'd say gratitude, I mean, it's a really essential habit for any high achiever out there, because you have to look at what you've done instead of having this more and more and more concepts where you sacrifice things you shouldn't be sacrificing, like family time, stuff like that, for goals that maybe you don't desperately need. They're goals that you should go after, but they're goals that if they come a little later or you approach it differently, that's not too bad. So you're spending time with your family, which is great, and people have different examples of that. But gratitude, definitely a great habit. With that in mind, Seth, I'm wondering if you could share with us some of the other habits you've developed that you would say are essential for your success.
Sure. Thank you. You know, one of the things that has really helped me is zeroing in on, you know, what it is that will be the grid by which I measure where I'm spending my energy. And so for me, I have a kind of a life mission statement, which is I want to reach for my potential. I want to impact my world. And I want to leave a legacy. And so as I'm thinking about the activities that I undertake, you know, starting with reach for my potential, I always say, you know, nobody wants to hear that they've tapped out their potential. That would be kind of, you know, morbid and demoralizing to hear, hey, you're done, Marc. You're never going to, it's not going to get any better than this, right? You know, you're always going to be reaching. And so I think those of us that have been gifted and given opportunities, you know, we have this sense of, I want to live up to that. I want to push. I want to see how well I can do, right? We have to be careful that that doesn't become overwhelming to us and we set this irrational view of what our potential is, right? If I were to tell you I'm going to be an NBA star and you're like, hey, you're 5'9" on a good day, buddy, and you never played basketball, that would be irrational, right? But if we can have courage and really challenge ourselves to reach for our potential, you know, we will know that we're reaching for our potential if we're growing, right? If we're stretching ourselves and we're learning and we're not sandbagging because we're afraid of either becoming too much into our ego or afraid of failure, there's both of those things hold us back. You know, sometimes we're worried about getting a big head and sometimes we're worried about failing. And neither of those things will get us towards our potential, but to always be pushing and growing for me is a big part of what makes me tick, right? And then the piece around impact is, for me, I've discovered that sometimes, and this, I think social media feeds into this, we can begin to think about those people out there that we're trying to reach and make a platform and a name for ourselves. And we'll actually overlook the people that are in our lives that are closest to us. And so if you're, you know, have a family, it's your kids, right? It's your wife. It's the people at your kids' school. It's the business people around you that look to you as a mentor. You know, we can be so worried about catching the people on the other side of the interweb that we actually step right over the top of people who really could benefit from the wisdom and the experience we have. And so are we impacting those that are right next to us? And I think that looks like serving. you know, how do we have impact? It's service. It's taking care of the people that are around you. And I think if we do those things well, if we reach for our potential and we impact our world, like right around us, that sets us up for this issue of legacy. And in my mind, leaving a legacy is really a legacy of values. It's probably not a building that's named after me. It's what did that guy teach and believe and model, and did he love me? How did he make me feel? That's really, I think, the legacy that we're going to leave. And so I try to have this filter and use it from time to time to check myself to say, all right, are you really doing things that live up to that? Or are you off in areas that aren't really moving that needle? And, you know, use it to maybe eliminate things that aren't giving me a sense that I'm using the grid properly.
Seth, I really love the habits that really align with the growth and impact that you're seeking, something that we definitely advocate for over here at Breakthrough Success. So like just that idea, if you keep growing every single day, your ability to have that impact is going to grow, and then you're going to get closer to your goals. And if you're growing in all these different areas, then you can hit your goals and you can do all the other things that you wanted to do, like spend time with your family and live that happy lifestyle. So definitely some really great habits there. For people who want to stay in touch and follow Seth, I know he has his book, Ambition, which will be in the show notes, but I am wondering if you have other ways for us to just continue to stay in touch and follow you on your journey.
Sure. A lot of that can be found at readambition.com. That's my personal website. I have a podcast there called the Business Done Right podcast, and all the socials are there. Also cathedralconsulting.com to find me. You know, what we do for day work is we help inspire leaders to grow value in their business and also to capture that value when they get ready to sell the business. That's an area that we're privileged to serve. And again, I really appreciate being able to be on your platform, Marc, and get to talk to your audience. So really grateful for the time together.
Seth, thank you so much for sharing those resources and all of your great insights throughout our time together. It was such a pleasure to have you on Breakthrough Success.
Excellent. Talk to you soon.